The three letters GIS has changed my life, and it probably has changed yours too without you even knowing it. And that's not such a bold claim, because GIS stands for Geographic Information Systems. And in a geographic information system, you connect data with geography. In essence, GIS is at the crossroads of computer science and geography, and I equate GIS to anything that is map related. And I've been really lucky in my previous job and my current job to work on a whole host of different projects using mapping. These projects include terrain analysis used for the military, or global land classification using machine learning, or measuring the effectiveness of poppy field eradication in countries like Afghanistan, or finding patterns in social media usage after natural disasters. And in the county, I basically use GIS for all the departments, from human services to public works, to parks and elections. Every day is different, and every day I'm learning something new. And I know that I'm making a difference on a global scale and in my local community by working on real, actionable projects. So when I had the opportunity, I made sure that my daughter was named after the love of my life. Here's a picture of her birth announcement. I try not to make it too obvious what her initials are. I fooled you too. But to demonstrate the power, to demonstrate the power that maps have to introduce a new perspective to the world, I want to bring up Jon Snow. And no, I don't mean Jon Snow from Game of Thrones. So in the mid-19th century, there was a global pandemic called cholera. And cholera had symptoms like severe dehydration and diarrhea. And if left untreated, cholera can lead to death. Now, cholera was thought to have been spread through a foul-smelling gas called miasma. This miasma theory had originated in the Middle Ages and had lasted for several centuries. And that's until Jon Snow entered the picture. Jon Snow is a London-based physician, and he had theorized that instead of being spread through the air, that cholera was spread through the water. And his theory didn't have too much traction until he mapped it. Now, this is a map of all the cases of cholera deaths in an area of London around Broad Street. And he had noticed that a cluster of these deaths happened around a public water pump. He was able to use this map to convince officials to remove the pump handle, and the cholera deaths had decreased significantly. So Jon Snow and others like him were able to question the miasma theory and introduce a new theory, the germ theory. So in a sense, spatial thinking was able to change the face of modern medicine. But maps can do even more than that. They can start conversations about anything. So let's talk about basketball. If you're not familiar with basketball, there are three ways to score points. You can score 1 point at the free throw line, 2 points if you score within this area of the court, and 3 points if you score within this area. Now, that line, that curved line that's in between the 2 point and 3 point areas is called the 3 point line. But did you know that this 3 point line was not introduced to the NBA until 1979? That introduction was arguably the biggest rule change in modern sports history. And the reason why I can argue that is because somebody mapped it. And that somebody is Kirk Goldberry. He's a cartographer, a college professor, and a basketball enthusiast. In his book, he featured the shooting efficiencies of players throughout the NBA. Now let's look at this particular player. In the 2015 basketball season, he had shot in different areas of the court, but he only went past the three-point line maybe 1% of the time. But in 3 years, he totally transformed the way he played. 66% of his shots were beyond the three-point line. And this trend is seen in other places in the NBA, in different players. Now the NBA has maybe one-third of their shots attempted or beyond the line, and this number is growing every year. Now, without knowing too much about basketball, I think you can imagine how boring it would be to watch a player dribble to the same areas of the court and shoot without any strategy or any playing of a position. And not only did the play of basketball change, but the faces of basketball has changed. Because teams are now looking at more long-range shooters, they're not really paying attention to tall players. Goldsberry had noticed this change in the three-point line, and he introduced a possible solution. Have each home court decide the position and placement of their own three-point line. And that way, whenever different teams would come and visit, they would have to adapt new strategies. And their teams would also have to be made up of players of different abilities. Snow and Goldsberry are examples of two people that were able to use the power of data visualization that maps have. But with like any powerful tool, maps could be misrepresented. Now, this XKCD comic is an example of this misrepresentation. These maps look the same, and why is that? Well, if you're displaying data that's population-based, a lot of heat maps and color-themed maps that use this data would look basically the same. For instance, if you wanted to map all the dogs in the United States, they would follow where the people are. Where there's a person, there could be a dog. And so it looks like a population map. Another example I wanted to give was if you have limited data. And using this to illustrate this example, I'm going to use a map that you've probably seen at least once in the past 2 years. And that is the Johns Hopkins COVID-19 dashboard. This dashboard is a massive undertaking showing the cases, deaths, and vaccine information for COVID-19 in different countries throughout the world. But I wanted to direct your attention to this cluster of maps right here in Europe. This cluster of dots in Europe. It looks as if there are cases spread all throughout Italy. But when you look at France, even though they have cases, it definitely doesn't look as bad. But when you look at the left side, the raw data, you can see that France actually has more cases than Italy. Now, why is this? If you look closer, Italy reports their data by city, whereas France reports for the full country. So while this dashboard doesn't represent false data, the data visualization inconsistencies because of the data limitations can lead a viewer to see something different. And on the topic of COVID-19, I wanted to bring up two maps published from the state of Georgia. Now, these maps were published in July 2020, a few weeks apart. And if you didn't look at the legend, you would think that nothing really has changed between these two dates. A lot of the counties look the same. But when you look at the labels, at the legend, then you can see that the numbers have actually increased. But let's put that aside. What is really worrisome about this are the color choices for the map. Generally, red means bad, and blue invokes a calm feeling. So these red counties look like outliers. They seem to pop out of nowhere. And the blue ones that could be one case off from being red are blue, and they definitely don't invoke a sense of urgency. A more responsible way to symbolize this is to have a gradual color gradient from red to blue. Note that these two maps show the same data set, but they convey two different stories. Once you change the scale, you change the story. Map makers have a great responsibility to show data accurately, but you as the viewer have a responsibility to look at maps critically, ask questions, and be skeptical. So what can you do with all of this information? You heard what I could do with GIS about all the different subjects I was able to use maps in. And what John Snow was able to do in order to change the perspective of the world. And that Kirk Goldsberry was able to do to introduce data-driven dialogue for something that he loves. I'm hoping that these examples invoke your sense of wonder and curiosity in the world. I challenge you to think about your life, your work, things you do every day, and now think about them spatially. Thinking spatially may help you discover answers to questions you didn't know you had. You may discover patterns, or maybe more insights than you can have conversations with your friends about. Once you think spatially, you can see that you can apply that to anything and everything. And remember, it's never too late to fall in love with maps. Thank you.